Down Mexico way, that's where I fell in love when the stars above came out to play. And now as I wander, my thoughts ever stray south of the border, down Mexico way.
Hello, Kent Edens here with episode 3 of the DMA podcast. In this edition, we take a look at Dean Martin's time as America's top secret agent with music, excerpts, and some rare radio spots not heard since their original U.S. broadcasts. We will also hear from Dino himself. Welcome to the Matt Helm Years. In 1959, author Donald Hamilton created a grim and ruthless assassin for the U.S. paperback mass market, a World War II veteran brought out of retirement to work for a secret agency. The character was the American answer to Ian Fleming's James Bond, a British secret agent who had already been a literary sensation since 1953. Matt Helm has never attained the dizzying heights of 007, but his first appearance in the 1960 novel Death of a Citizen set in motion a phenomenal run of 27 books, all written by Hamilton, the last being The Damagers in 1993. Ian Fleming only managed 14 Bond novels in his lifetime, with almost another 30 from 8 continuation authors. Donald Hamilton was born in 1916 in Sweden, arriving in New York with his mother and sisters in 1924. They were to join his father, who was a doctor and already residing in Boston. Hamilton perfected his pulp fiction style of writing after the Second World War with submissions to Reinhardt in 1954 that followed a number of short stories published by Collier's Weekly and the Saturday Evening Post. Hamilton's last volume featuring Matt Helm was written in 2002 and remains unpublished. The author died in 2006, and whether or not The Dominators sees the light of day is anyone's guess. The early literal success of the character led to Columbia Pictures buying the rights to the novels, having been optioned by producer Irwin Allen in 1964. Interestingly, Allen had previously been in a working partnership with one Albert R. Broccoli, who wanted to buy the rights to Ian Fleming's anti-hero. Allen wasn't interested in James Bond, and after the two producers went their separate ways, Broccoli joined forces with Harry Saltzman and United Artists. Broccoli and Saltzman, of course, went on to make Dr. No in 1962. The 25th Bond movie, currently going by the working title of Shatterhand, is due for release in 2020. The Bond phenomenon was already at its peak by the time The Silencers went into production. Based very loosely on Death of a Citizen and the fourth novel, The Silencers, published in 1962, it reworked Matt Helm into an easygoing retired secret agent who had turned to photography as a hobby. Called back into action by his old boss, Mac, Helm's agency was ICE, an acronym for Intelligence and Counter-Espionage. The books, however, never explicitly revealed who it was Helm actually worked for. Dino signed on for 5 movies, and his natural charm and charisma were a perfect match for director Phil Carlson's lighthearted interpretation of Donald Hamilton's tough and brutal literary original. It was also a clear spoof of James Bond. Dino's own company, Medway Claude, co-produced this and the sequels. Columbia Pictures' British press release from April 1966 described Matt Helm as,
"The Silencers introduces the ruthless, virile, suave, sardonic, reckless, handsome, and amorous American ICE agent Matt Helm to the screen in the dynamic person of Dean Martin. Helm could be described as the reluctant agent whose official full-time job is as a top glamour photographer. He much prefers gals to guns, beds to bombs, and clinches to karate. As someone recently remarked, Matt Helm takes the spark out of Flint, makes Uncle look like Auntie, and 007 a bad number."
This is a villain. A typical villain.
"I'm going to destroy the world by pressing this little purple button."
This is also a villain. A very special villain. The kind that turns up only in The Silencers.
"And do I look like an enemy agent?"
This is a special agent. A typical agent.
"You press that purple button and I'll blow your pink head off."
This is also a special agent. He's hot, he's hip, he's Matt Helm, and he's only in The Silencers.
"I couldn't help noticing, but these are your clothes."
"What if they are?"
"I know you have a headache, but don't take it out on me."
Columbia Pictures presents Dean Martin as Matt Helm in The Silencers, with Stella Stevens, Dahlia Lavi, and Sid Charisse. The Silencers were shot in Columbia color.
With a script by Oscar Saul and Herbert Baker, The Silencers was a major box office hit for Columbia and Medway Claude following its release on February the 18th, 1966. Making over $16 million at the box office, it seemed Bond had serious competition. But Matt Helm's domination of the cinema may have been in part due to the fact that there was no Bond movie in 1966. Thunderball had been released the previous year, with Casino Royale and You Only Live Twice both out in 1967. Music was by the legendary Elmer Bernstein, with the title song performed by Vicky Carr. Sid Charisse cameoed in the opening credits, miming to Vicky's singing while performing an enticing burlesque dance. 2 soundtracks were released. Elmer's score on RCA Victor and a selection of songs featured in the movie and sung by Dino for Reprise Records. Riding high on their success, Columbia quickly commissioned a sequel, Murderers Row.
"Hi there, this is Dean Martin saying hello from Hollywood. I was very pleased to hear you're having a Dean Martin week in Britain, and I'd like to say thanks to everyone concerned, particularly the barmaids. I wish I could be with you in person, but since I can't, I'm sending along my latest record. It's a song I sing in the Irving Allen production, Murderer's Row. It's based on the life and times of Frank Sinatra. It's called I'm Not the Marrying Kind. I hope you like it. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you."
"I go my way alone, free and easy like a rolling stone. I am strictly on my own, not the marrying kind. I'm happy being free."
Helm's a poppin'. Matt Helm's 2 spectacular adventures in one great action show, Murderer's Row and The Silencers, both starring Dean Martin as Matt Helm.
Thrill to the world of Matt Helm, top secret agent, as he battles to save America from being destroyed by a lot of terrible men.
Two Matt Helms are better than one for double excitement, twofold fun, and twice as many girls. See Dean Martin live it up with Anne Margaret, Stella Stevens, Dahlia Lavi, Sid Charisse, Camilla Spar, Beverly Adams, and a double bevy of gorgeous slaygirls in Murderer's Row and The Silencers. Dean Martin is double barrel trouble and excitement in Murderer's Row and The Silencers, both in color, both from Columbia Pictures.
Herbert Baker returned to write the script, based, again very loosely, on the 1962 book of the same name. Baker was well known to Dean, having penned a handful of Martin Lewis pictures and some editions of the Dean Martin television show. Many of the location sequences were either studio mock-ups or exterior set dressings. Second unit teams did, however, go to Monte Carlo and the Isle of Wight, the latter for the hovercraft sequences. Dino had contacted the DMA saying he was going to be filming on the tiny UK island, and Columbia organized a hotel for Bernard to stay in to meet with and watch him film some of the dailies. But Dino ultimately decided he didn't want to travel to Europe, so a stand-in was used for both the Isle of Wight and Monte Carlo.
Hi, this is Dean Martin, speaking for Columbia Pictures. I'm here to tell you all about our new Matt Helm adventure, Murderer's Row. It's a grabber. Oh, of course, there's that wonderful girl with the two first names, Anne Margaret. Carl Malden rises to new heights as a rotten human being. And since Hollywood is always on the lookout for new faces, it's a pleasure to introduce the Slay Girls in Murderer's Row. They have plenty of lines, and they even get to say a few of them. Thrill to the world of Matt Helm, top secret agent, as he battles to save America from being destroyed by a lot of terrible men.
Raw, brutal, stark, turbulent, wild, and devil-may-care. The picture that dares to ask the question, how about it?
See Dean Martin, Anne Margaret, Carl Malden, Camilla Spar, and a dozen Slay Girls in Murderer's Row, Technicolor.
Murderer's Row fared well at the December 1966 box office, released on the 20th and latching on to the Christmas market. While not remotely as successful as The Silencers, earning just $6.2 million across the U.S. and Canada, it was nevertheless the 11th highest-grossing film of that year. Lalo Schifrin took over scoring duties, creating an impressive, upbeat soundtrack with a theme that easily competed against John Barry's finest action motifs. Next up was The Ambushers, released on the 22nd of December, 1967.
Sipping lemonade, they get you at the flicks. Though the world may call them chicks, they strike man like wow. They're the ambushers. They get you when you're high, they get you when you're short. You is just their favorite indoor-outdoor sport. They get you in a mink, off the deep end in the drink. Female, female, wham. They're the ambushers. Blonde and a brunette lie in wait like engines in the grass. You're coming through the pass. Then Buster, your General Custer. Ah, they get you with the hay.
Hey!
They get you in disguise. They get you with their lips, their hips, and their smile, their style, their eyes. They get you cheek to cheek, down the aisle and up the creek. In chase, next case, wow.
It bared little, if no resemblance, to the original novel from 1963. Its working title was The Devastators, which was itself a 1965 Helm novel. The plot for that book was, again, nothing like the finished movie. Screenwriter Herbert Baker also wrote the music, alongside Hugo Montenegro, who had found a career as an orchestrator as well as a composer, creating scores for a number of Columbia movies.
In The Ambushers, Dean Martin as Matt Helm faces a firing squad, gets a karate chop in a steam bath, is punched in the mouth, gets shot at in a brewery, falls into a beer vat, is it in a game of tag to kill, is almost hit by a runaway train, mowed down by a speeding motorcycle, and is kicked, punched, and beaten.
Poor Matt Helm.
Oh, they get you with a hand.
Adventure takes on a new boldness as Matt Helm takes on the Ambushers in sunny, sexy, sinful Acapulco. See Dean Martin in The Ambushers. The Ambushers. See them dressed to kill by Cassini.
They're The Ambushers.
The Ambushers from Columbia Pictures in Technicolor. Suggested for mature audiences.
Bringing home $10 million, it still piqued interest in the American film-going public, and so a fourth installment was virtually a guarantee.
On the street of many pleasures, stands a house of seven joys. Like you see it in the movies, it's for groovy girls and boys. In this Oriental path, you are welcome night and day. Recommended by Matt Helm and by the A-A-A.
Dean Martin, Chuck Norris, Bruce Lee. Three names, three figures you wouldn't necessarily put in the same sentence, the same room, or the same movie. But they all worked on The Wrecking Crew. Dino is the star, of course, Chuck Norris in his uncredited film debut, and Bruce Lee as the advisor for the karate fight scenes. It opened on February the 5th, 1969, and, like its predecessors, The Wrecking Crew's plot had nothing much to do with the original 1960 novel. Ex-police reporter turned crime writer William P. McGiven took the writing credit here, replacing Baker. Hugo Montenegro returned for scoring duties. Mac David and Frank Duvall wrote the theme called The House of Seven Joys, so named as it was the working title of the film. It brought home a pitiful $2.4 million at the box office, and as a result, Dino refused to commit to any more. And so The Ravishers, revealed at the end of The Wrecking Crew, as coming next in the series, was shelved, thereby keeping the movie Matt Helm firmly in the 1960s. The next project for Dino would be Airport, the first in a long line of contemporary disaster movies, and Dino's most successful film, earning a cool $100 million at the box office.
You gotta give a little, take a little, and let your poor heart break a little.
As we've already established, Matt Helm lived on in his original guise in mass market novels. The complete 27 title run was reprinted in the UK by Titan Books between 2013 and 2017, and are well worth tracking down.
Skyboat Media presents The Wrecking Crew by Donald Hamilton. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. Chapter 1. I awoke early, shaved, dressed, draped myself with cameras and equipment, and went on deck to record our entry into the port of Gothenburg. I couldn't think of a likely market for the shots, but I was supposed to be an eager and ambitious freelance photographer, and I'd be expected to be alert to the chance that somebody would fall overboard or the ship would hit something. And nothing happened. And after we were safely docked, I went down to breakfast, after which I came back up to the smoking room for passport inspection. Finally, I was shunted down the gangplank into the arms of the Swedish Customs, where I braced myself to justify my possession of $1,000 worth of photographic gear and several hundred rolls of film, having been warned that European countries are touchy about this sort of thing. It was a bum steer. Nobody paid any attention to the cameras and film. The only part of my belongings that caused a mild official interest was the guns.
Columbia Pictures Television developed and made a TV series in 1975 starring Anthony Franciosa. And this time, Helm was a private detective, retired from a spy organization called The Machine. It did not resemble the books and was unconnected to the film series. Ratings were low, and the series did not see life beyond 13 episodes of standard 1970s detective-style stories. They were never repeated outside the U.S. and to date have not been released on DVD or been made available for streaming. Here's the theme, though, composed by Morton Stevens, who was famous for his music for Hawaii Five-O. Talk of a movie team-up between Frank Sinatra's movie detective Tony Rome and Dino's Matt Helm never came to anything more but talk. Seeing as the two Rome films, Tony Rome and Lady in Cement, were neo-noir, and the four Helms were spy spoofs, it's stretching it somewhat to believe how they could ever inhabit the same fictional universe. If Helm was to ever have easily crossed into another character's movie, then surely it would have been alongside James Bond in Casino Royale, which was a bizarre and surreal take on Fleming's first novel. The Matt Helm movies themselves were, from the onset, very far removed from Donald Hamilton's books. Across the four movies, we are witness to increasingly outrageous, flirtatious female agents, extraordinary life-or-death situations, comedy gadgets, impossible outcomes, Frank Sinatra in-jokes, and blatant drunk driving. But because it's Dino up there on screen, being himself more than any other of his film roles, we're happy to be swept along for the ride.
There'll be times when you'll find yourself in a romantic situation with an enemy agent. You've got to just let yourself go. You know, be soft and yielding. A little champagne.
I don't drink.
A little love.
I don't drink.
Well, soft lights and music. Oh, especially music. That'll do it every time. Just relax and... Now, you pay close attention.
You can count on me, sir.
Everybody loves somebody sometimes.
Nice voice.
I'm sorry, Mr. Helm. I guess I'm just not in the mood.
Something in your kiss. Strangers in the night. Exchanging glances.
Oh, kiss me.
Mm-hmm. You really like Perry Como that much?
Looking, too, at the progression of the official Bond movies, they also became pastiches of Ian Fleming's novels, particularly through the Roger Moore years, and so we owe much to the tongue-in-cheek style Martin swaggered across the screen with in the late 1960s. It's interesting to consider that the Matt Helm movies were originally designed as light-hearted imitations of the Bonds, but Bond himself started emulating Helm in the 1970s. Roger and Dino would go on to share screen time in 1981 for the Cannonball Run, where Roger spoofed his own take on Bond, which in part had spoofed Dino's Matt Helm. Further, in 1997, a new 60s-era super spy emerged from the mind of Mike Myers to great success, a creation that echoed many of Matt Helm's trademark mannerisms, no less being him a semi-photographer by day and a shagadelic secret agent by night, the one and only Austin Powers. The DMA was one of the first to report in 2009 that DreamWorks had purchased the rights to the Matt Helm novels. In 2018, it was revealed that Bradley Cooper had been attached to the role with a treatment from Tom Shepard for a potential first movie in a new franchise. George Clooney and Steven Spielberg are producing. But if something does ever get made, the Matt Helm we will see will never have the panache, the cool and the effortless charm that the late, great Dean Martin instilled in him so easily. You've been listening to The Matt Helm Years, Episode 3 of the DMA Podcast, with me, Kent Edens, and written by Elliot Thorpe.
This podcast was produced by Kent Edens for the Dean Martin Association and is copyright 2019, Shaken Not Stirred Productions, and is not to be copied or used in whole or in part without prior permission. Links and credits read by Del Fuller. Please visit shakenstir.com. Please visit DeanMartinAssociation.com.